Welcome to the May 23rd edition of 30 with Tony. We have the best subjects, the boss's music, and the greatest classic clips. So let's get it on, Kimo Sabi.
Well, hi, my good Kimasabis. It's Tony D'Angelo here. So happy to have you on this edition of 30 with Tony. It is May 23rd. Got to look at the date really quick. Yes, May 23rd. Anno Domini in the year of our Lord. And I'm just so pleased and so proud of all of you and new fans and new friends and new people were getting upset along the way and could not do it without you. I'm also grateful to our music contributors. I think we're going to have some incredibly boss music this week. Don't you like the beginning? And then we're going to do some classic clips a little bit later or a classic clips. I mean, you only get that on this show. I mean, if nothing else, come back and see the music. Come back and see the classic clips. But we do have serious business to discuss today. Our subject today is a big bite of nothing. A big bite of nothing. And I was doing a little reading over the weekend, and guess what? Connecticut has a hunger problem. Now, I am not going to make fun of hungry people. Okay, let's get that straight right now. I grew up in a household and was drilled into me by my mother, and it is still within me today, and it will be in me until the day I am no longer here, that no person around my, shall I say, frame of reference shall go hungry. No one will go without a meal. No one will go without food. And I do my best to live that. Our firm represents a food bank pro bono, years and years and years, thousands of dollars of services we just do and give. Because to the extent we can do this, hungry people can eat. You know, it's not some food chain, it's not some place for politicians to come and, you know, cheer and talk about how awful everything is. But that is an important thing to me. So I can assure you that the biggest problem in hungry people is twofold, especially in a non-working, bureaucratically inept, administrative state-loving state like Connecticut, is number one, politicians and bureaucracy, and number two, inability for people to have gainful and suitable employment so that they can pay their own bills. You see, this is just it. People will look out for themselves and do for themselves if you let them do it. The political system does not want for that to happen because political system, you know, they need to do something and they need to find a way to oppress you and to, you know, quote unquote, make policy upon you so they themselves could get bigger and fatter and you will pay more and more taxes and you will pay more and more at the grocery store and your employers will find it more and more difficult for you to have a job. So they'll lay you off and then you're at the mercy of unemployment, the food banks, and then you don't have enough to eat. This is where it all comes down to. And this has not changed for years and years and years and years and years. And we're going to look at a couple of things today, and we're also going to look at solutions. Now, the solutions against hunger, the solutions I'm going to give you are, they've been proposed before, they've never been refuted. And because of the gutless, lily-livered, incompetent, inept politicians in this state on both sides, yes, some albeit worse than others, you'll never see these things enacted unless you yourself go to these people and shake them, not physically, of course, do not lay your hands on them, but shame them into saying, why don't you do something to finally make something work? Because it hasn't worked until now. We have more hungry than ever. We have more people without jobs than ever. We see businesses closing left and right. The restaurant industry, under the domain of King Governor Ned Lamont the Unaccountable, has taken an incredible, and that's a money industry for working people. It's taken a major beating. And, you know, who cares, right? You know, government goes on. Government does wonderful things. You know, more paid sick days, more administrations, more cronies, more whatever. But anyway, we're going to look at some things and I'm going to show you the problem and I'm going to show you the solution. And you, politician, I want you to look at this and tell me and shame me and tell me why this doesn't work. Obviously, it may have something to do with, you know, you not having a job, but is the object you not having a job, or is the object to feed hungry people? This is very personal to me. So let's go. Let's do a little bit of a screen share here. Actually, there's really no such thing as a little bit of a screen share. And here we go. This weekend, I was reading this article. We'll show you several. And we talk about food insecurity. This is the CT Mirror. And this is written by, I believe, a young lady, Erica E. Phillips. Again, I have to qualify that these days. And Feeding America is a major nonprofit with respect to nutrition and feeding and people not having enough food in the United States of America. They found Connecticut's food insecure population grew by 90,000 in 2022. Many of them were children. Now, interesting that term food insecure. I guess Some bureaucrat somewhere had to have a cooler term for, I don't know where my next meal is coming from, or I'm hungry, but we're meaning the same thing. But they've got to have buzzwords and things, because this way they it gives them a reason to take your tax money for employment, and kind of makes them think they know more than you, but they don't. Now, in a state that ranks the top 10 wealthiest, nearly 500,000 people don't know where their next meal is coming from. Thank you, Miss Phillips. Why didn't you lead the article with that? 1 in 8 Connecticut residents experience food insecurity, rising from 1 in 10, according to the latest annual Map the Meal Gap report for hunger relief organization Feeding America. Now, the number, whatever statistics you're using, and I don't think they're wrong. The number of people considered food insecure in the state rose from 90,000 to 400, knows by 90,000 to $470,000. Now, this is where the rubber meets the road. Funding the unmet need for food assistance in Connecticut would cost over $375 million, the report estimated. The state's current annual budget allocates $850,000 to the Connecticut Nutrition Assistance Program, CTNAP. We definitely have a way to go here, says Jason Jabakowski, if I'm pronouncing that correctly, president of Connecticut Food Share, said at a press conference. He added that Massachusetts and New York each spend over $30 million on their respective hunger assistance programs. Now, Jabakowski was joined by a bipartisan group of state lawmakers who pledged one by one to devote millions more dollars in public funds to the food banks and food pantries that provide for residents in every district of the state. Now, if you go over to here, this is an article we're going to probably be flipping back and forth from the CT News Junkie, my boy here, Hudson Camphausen. Legislators and advocates demand more support for food pantries, called for changes to fiscal guardrails. And here you have your, you hate to say it, but your usual cast of characters. There's our, more or less our, how can I put it? The patron saint in the legislature of all things downtrodden, Eleni Converse DeGraw. And the crying out for the need for food is before us once again politically. Let's just jump back here to the Connecticut Mirror. And it says here, but that won't happen for at least another year. A bill proposing to raise the state's annual contribution to NAP from 10 million, co-sponsored by 60 members of the legislature, died without getting a public hearing. The General Assembly decided not to reopen budget negotiations during the second year of the biennium, meaning many bills that would have required new funding were jettisoned. We certainly hope to get back to this next year. I hope that we'll be doing that with these co-sponsors and more. Now, one question here I want you to ask yourself. This is easy for you, my Kemosabe, to get a handle on, but it's lost on folks like this. Why is it that no matter what we do, no matter what we give to feed the hungry people, the need is always greater? Well, there's an economic reason for that, number one. One is, were these people here were yell and scream about, you've got to explode the fiscal guardrails. In my estimation, the fiscal guardrails are illusory. It's the equivalent of watching your spending when your house is falling apart. Bob Swick had an excellent article on that a couple of months back that I think you should read, that really tells you exactly what the fiscal guardrails are, especially with the huge amount of, unanswered for deficits in the billions in Connecticut. But when you look at this thing here, they all cry about the fiscal guardrails, and you got to get rid of them. And you got to meet the immediate need. Now, These are the same people, the same damned people who will tell you that fossil fuels are evil and you can't have fossil fuels and you're causing respiratory distress in the cities and. But when I come to them and say, well, you've got to use affordable fuel, natural gas, nuclear, get rid of some gasoline taxes to drive costs down so the cost of goods and services could go down and make things more affordable and make businesses feel like they could invest in something. Well, no, we can't do that. But these are the same group of idiots that will take these fiscal guardrails in a second and trash them for whatever little value the fiscal guardrails give you. And we feed the hungry. Well, guess what? Once you're fed, you're not fed forever. So if you're gonna address the root cause of air pollution, which honestly, I think a lot of that is hooky baba nonsense, not entirely, not entirely. I'm not anti-environment. Come here, check me, check what I do. But if you're going to address that on a purist level, when it comes to food insecurities, just tax everybody and throw the treasury at them. And we've solved something, ain't we great? But you still have the problem. Why do you have the problem? Number one, the cost of fuel. And number two, somebody wants to eat, they're hungry. They're not interested in becoming part of some political cause as we come down here. What do these people make? What do these legislatures make to cry the poor mouth? Here's a guy here from a food bank. He's crying. They don't have enough food. Pal, I get it, but the problem is around you. The problem is not getting more money. We'll get to that in a little bit. Go down here a little bit. Here's Jason Jakubowski of Food Share. What's he make? I have no idea. I don't know if he's a competent man. I don't know if he's an incompetent man. I can tell you that going back to my days of working with the Connecticut Food Bank in New Haven, and when the original executive director, Nancy Carrington, a lovely lady, a lovely, competent, decent lady, resigned, there was a series of whatever you want to call it, kind of musical CEOs there. I believe me, some of them I really don't know what their purpose was in there, but they were there and they were getting very good salaries. But now you've got this thing called Connecticut Food Share, and it's like, but no matter how many politicians and bureaucrats you throw at this thing, people are still hungry. And why? And why? This is the question I ask. I mean, is there, me, myself, and I, as a private business person, as a person that does not have the luxury of committees and studies and the administrative state that the whole freaking Connecticut political system is in love with, I look for the shortest distance between two points to get something done. I'm looking at six people on a stage crying for more money. That's what I'm looking at. Let's get back to the other article. So, as we read down here, talking a little bit about food and sorry about that. Sometimes I get overzealous. Food insecurity is defined by the U.S. Department of Agriculture as not having enough to eat. How about that? How about that? Oh, my Lord. What did we pay somebody to give us that definition? And not knowing where their next meal will come from. Oh, my God. God help us all. In Connecticut, food insecurity rose sharply amid elevated inflation, affecting more than 44 million Americans, according to Feeding America. Hey, wait a minute. Aren't we in the Connecticut comeback? Aren't we in Connecticut is the number one place to live and to work and to do business? Then, why do they feed us these lies? No pun intended, but why do we have all these hungry people? And then we talk about the hungry children and that sort of thing. Now, this is interesting here. If one person in the state has to worry about where their food is coming from or miss a meal, or the kid doesn't have to, that is a tragedy. If nearly 500,000 people are experiencing that every day, that's a crisis, says Christian Duborg, a food and nutrition policy analyst with the General Assembly. A food and nutrition policy analyst with the General Assembly. Question from the inept people that live and work here in the state. Why does the General Assembly need a food and nutrition policy analyst? I'm presuming most people can read the labels on the backs of food, or they can do internet research, or they could go to a library or something like this. So we're paying somebody in the legislature to analyze nutrition policy. I mean, shouldn't that really be going for bags of groceries, milk and formula for babies? But Connecticut, that's not Connecticut's way of solving a problem. Connecticut in its history could not have a cross pipe between two standpipes. It just, we need a study. We need it's some growth of the administrative state. And you read down a little bit, and this, sorry for the jumping screen. The director of the Plymouth Community Food Bank in Terryville, he talked about his statistics, talking about hungry children. Now, reading down here, Connecticut Food Share, which supplies food to many of the state's food pantries, is funded mostly through private donations and corporate sponsors, and the last 3% is public funding. And if we go over to here, to this other article, back to our cast of characters, you have all these legislators crying the poor mouth, saying that kids need food and we need more funding. Okay, let's read down a little bit before I start with this. Connecticut Food Share receives almost no money from the state, said Mr. Jakubowski. And he talks about what the other states received. Here's the first indicia of the problem from the esteemed Miss Kavros de Gras. There are no bootstraps big enough to pull yourself up when you're already working two jobs, Kavros de Gras said, adding that government should provide a safety net. Okay. Government should provide a safety net. I'll say that two more times. Government should provide a safety net. And she hopes Connecticut will provide more aid in the future to the people who need it. Ms. Kavros de Gras, your solutions for food insecurity, hunger, are equivalent to your solutions for housing. Why does government have to provide the safety net? Why do we need government in the first place to feed hungry people? Well, you have groups and studies, and you have people over here like the food and nutrition analyst. Actually, scroll back to him. I don't know if Christian DeBoer is identifies as a man or a woman. I have little to no information on Christian DeBoer. Can't find a salary or anything like that. Must be a reasonably new hire, but why does government provide a solution? Because government's way of providing a solution is putting a nutrition policy analyst in the legislature. A lot of hamburgers that's going to buy, right? But anyway, reading down here. Look who else we have. Anwar, hey, how about it? If you want to have the most destructive domestic and city policy, talk to this man. This is a man that wants harm reduction centers in the cities for addicts. Again, he's against the shall we say the illusory guardrails. We need to have a conversation. Okay, Dr. Anwar, we will have a conversation. Actually, I kind of like calling you Anwar better. and he calls it a systemic failure. Okay. Here's a man who really is the living embodiment of the system. He works for a hospital. He's paid by a hospital. He's in the legislature, and he's saying the system is failing. But he indeed is the system. This is just so you got to give me more money so I can fail better. Now, Henry Martin said the state shouldn't abandon the guardrails, and that the legislature voted last year to extend the guardrails for another 5 years. Martin says policies have come through the legislature recently with the support of the Democratic majority. And he starts to pick at the Democrat policies, but yet the how could I put it? We don't see any conclusive or incisive solution from Senator Martin as to what number one caused the hunger situation and number two ways of healing it. Now, if you go over here to the cast of characters, each one of them, every single one of them, is their existence, their whatever you want to call it, their reason for being, their jobs are a tax dollar or a charitable dollar. You need to pay taxes, you need to have charity. But does it ever dawn on any of these people, ever, forever, that if you do something to deliver resources more efficiently, perhaps you don't need so many dollar-sucking bureaucrats and legislators and nutrition policy analysts to figure out why somebody's hungry? No, never, 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 never. Let alone, let's make fuel more affordable. Let's make business more profitable because businesses' costs will be down. Let's employ more people who could buy food at a lower price. No, that doesn't, But hey, there's a cloud. There's a cloud here today. We have to have a climate change emergency. I mean, lunacy is making people hungry. Do you get that, people? Lunacy, stupidity, and the worship of the administrative state is making people hungry. All these people get paid. All these people are getting their salaries. Meanwhile, somebody's going hungry. Now, I'm not against these people having jobs. I am against the waste of money, and I am against duplication. And where Ms. Kavros DeGraw over here said you need a government solution. Well, sorry, sorry, dearie. Government's the problem here and not the solution. It's not solving anything because it would stand to reason if you keep throwing money on top of something and throwing money on top of money, guess what? You got a problem. It's like if I walked out in my backyard and I said, I want to have a swimming pool, right? And I'm going to dig and dig and dig and dig, and I make a nice little ditch. And then I fill that ditch with water, but the water keeps seeping into the ground. There's a problem, right? I got to put something there to keep the water there so that I don't have to keep refilling it. But these people here, the only thing they see generally is the program. And here, all of the legislators are equally guilty because they listen to me. They follow me. I know that because anytime I say something, maybe not anytime and every time, but a lot of the times, they'll try to do something like it in the Republican Party and unfortunately usually fail miserably. But let's do two things here. Let's look at what got us into this mess. You see, this cast of characters doesn't look at what causes the mess. They're just begging for more money. They're crying the poor mouth. More programs, more bureaucracies, more. Rocking horse winner. There must be more money. There must be more money. There must be more money. But anyway, let's look at what's causing our issues. Remember this? 4 years ago, COVID-19, an article, Connecticut Mirror, and in the worst, most mismanaged, most ill thought out, most fix the thing right now and we'll worry about it later farce and sham, which was celebrated by the idiots in the political parties and, you know, championed by the media, who got a $72 million grant from the government to essentially lie to you. We had a crisis. Now, if you take away someone's employment, this to me is a very tragic scene. This is an article from the Connecticut Mirror in 2020. These are all the people at Rentschler Field who were lining up their cars. Now, look at those cars. Those are nice cars. You know, they're paying car payments. They're working and they're going to the football field because they need food. And did anybody in the government stop and say, hey, wait a minute, can we afford to kill our economy? Heck no. Kill the economy. Give King Governor Ned Lamont the unaccountable executive power. Then Republican turkeys are saying, I did a great job during COVID. He killed us. He killed us. Okay. Do you understand that? Maybe you do. Maybe you don't. I don't know. But anyway, he was killing us. I was yelling he was killing us. And you guys did nothing about it, basically. You didn't stop and say, hey, wait, hey, what's happening? I mean, you know, you talk about drastic measures. These people over here are talking about drastic measures. These people over here are talking about drastic measures. But when it came over here to COVID-19, you know, you all laid down like obedient dogs. And basically, this was Rentschler Field. And let's go to our friend, King Governor Ned Lamont, the unaccountable. Friend, I say facetiously. And he was there as, I am the savior, I am the source, I am the wonderful guy, I'm putting everything aside, I want to make sure you're safe, and I want to make sure you have enough food. So the root cause of all of this, you know, it's like 2019 just seems like a distant memory, in many ways it is. But the root cause of all of this was the Trump energy policy. I don't care if you hate Donald Trump, I don't care what you hate. But the Trump energy policies were very favorable to business development. The Section 190, the IRC Section 199 Cap A 20% business income deduction is very favorable to business development. We did not have the need which we did, but with the mismanagement of COVID-19, now in some ways I can't blame Ned for all of that. I mean, I do blame him, but basically Ned is not that creative to have made this all happen on his own. He was following what Boston Consulting told him. He was following what McKinsey told him. I mean, you know, Ned does not have that much imagination. But that being as it is, the root cause was the destruction of the economy and the veneration of, you know, Ned is keeping us safe. Well, actually, Ned keeping us safe is bringing us to this and to this. Good job, Ned. But, you know, he championed his well-being and he championed his whole thing of, you know, I am the person who is doing what's here. And, you know, people bought it, or whether they were invested in it or not, I don't know. But I mean, I said at that time, something's terribly wrong here. Would you please do something? And people did nothing. I went to Lenny Fasano with the Boston Consulting contract. And I said, which he himself had circulated on his email address, and said, Lenny, what's happening with these addresses and this personal information that's gone to this consulting company? Did anybody consider that? What's the purpose of all this? What's taking place here? Didn't say a word to me. I went to both of my state representatives at that time and said, what's going on here? One of them was a cop. Okay. And I said, you're a lousy cop. I mean, you know, you just saw a theft here. That was Dan Champagne. And I said, you didn't do anything, basically, you know. It's like, what's going on here? And then, you know, what you got here. I'm sorry, we're being real hard today. We need to be. Now you have this. So that was your root cause. These people are working the model of cause a problem and then let's have a fix and let's just come back and beg for more money. And let's have somebody like Anwar say the system has failed. Okay. That's number one. But let's look over to here. Actually, a little background on Mr. DeBorg, Ms. DeBorg, I'm not really sure. The 2015, I'm not the brightest person in the world. Actually, I think I can stop to share. In 2015, I was asked by Sean Cleary, a nice young man who was working at that time for the Greater New Haven Chamber of Commerce, to write proposals as to what would fix the tax system in the state of Connecticut. And I still have the whole thread. I still have the documents. And not that I would not have them. But relative to the discussion that we've had here today, bureaucracies, more people, more money, self-created destruction in the case of COVID-19, and all of that. And it's 30 million now, right? Whatever they're asking for, whatever Mr. Jakubowski was asking for, what's going to be, 60 million, 90 million? I mean, it's like, do we look at stopping the leaks? Well, no, of course not. Because that would obviate and eliminate the need for the bureaucracies, the politicians, the hangers-on, the programs. My sister Susie needs a job, and. But I made a proposal to the legislature, and they all read it. And most of them at that time were Republicans. And I said, you could fix the social ills in this state within a matter of a couple of years. A very easy, simple solution. Instead of legislators and programs and bureaucrats and we spend a lot of our money, obviously, in this duplication and this ineptitude and this stuff that doesn't work, that fails. It's now failing greatly. Instead of doing all that, why don't we set aside whatever the portion is in our budget for helping those in need? And let's have a checkbox election on a tax return, okay? By region, and say, you get a tax allocation. You're paying the same amount of taxes, okay? Your taxes aren't going to increase. But you have an allocation to say, I want this percentage of my taxes to go to this particular charity, feeding the need in my area, or feeding the hungry, or, basic human needs, heating, medical care, housing the homeless, and things like that, just basic stuff, and give the taxpayer the ownership. After all, it is the taxpayer's government, right? Give them the ownership of saying, now, which one of these charities is going to do the best job for my tax dollars? Most people will rise up to that. Most decent thinking people of whatever persuasion will rise up to that, and whatever political party. Now, what that's going to do is that's going to make the charities that are in the region perform better, because they're going to want to have the allocation, and they're going to have to account every single year for, this is what we did in order to use your resources and feed the hungry and shelter the homeless and a couple of other, basic medical, basic food needs. Let's just talk about food. Let's start with one thing. Instead of, my, say, 20% of my taxes every year goes to, social services, why don't I take 20% of my taxes and say, well, who's doing the best job here in my region in, doing what's best for people? And I'm going to contribute to them. And every year, these charities would have to have an annual report that they would swear to under penalty of perjury and say, this is what we did with your money. Okay, come back, do it again. We did it right the first time. And when that happens, the cream will rise, and the need for, services is going to meet the funding, And it'll be nonprofits, right-thinking nonprofits, not scummy nonprofits and politically connected nonprofits, and nonprofits like in the state of Connecticut that you can't get your hands on what they're doing. But it would go right there, and then you would eliminate, and by definition, the entire need for all the bureaucracies and hangers-on and poor mouths and nutrition policy analysts and all this other kind of stuff. But not one person has taken me up on my suggestion. Not one person has come to me and said, "Well, it can't work." I'll tell you why it doesn't work, because it basically eliminates the administrative state. It eliminates all the cronies. It eliminates all the garbage. It eliminates all the insecurity. It eliminates the Kavros DeGraw and Anwar involvement, and the shall I say, the Republican damning with faint praise. It eliminates all that because you have been obviated. Your usefulness, quote unquote, is no longer needed. But they don't do that. So I look at this, I look at this whole hunger thing, shall I say, with anger, with interest, and with a solution. My anger is that people are going hungry because of stupid politicians and stupid policies and pandering, and like in the case of King Governor Ned Lamont the Unaccountable, creating an economic disaster that he himself will never, ever, ever, nor the legislature will ever, ever, ever be able to get their way out of. I look at that. I look at the fact that there is a solution, and the solution is a performance-based model. And then I look at it where these same lunatics and these same gas bags are sitting there talking about, oh, climate change. And I'm not against climate change. I'm not saying, that our climate isn't changing. It's going to change anyway, whether we want it to or not. But, we can't have fossil fuels and all this other stuff. They will cut the vein of, the spending in a moment just to meet that momentary need and crash the thing into the ground, because that would increase their presence and decrease anything positive that could happen. How you build an economy is by low fuel prices and reducing taxes and reducing the bureaucracy and getting government the hell out of the way and let the private sector do what it needs to do. But Connecticut doesn't do that. And Connecticut needs to do that in order to survive. And it galls me because there'll be more and more hungry people and more cry in the poor mouth and more signs that are in the legislature saying, "We got to feed the hungry people." Well, maybe we can eliminate some salaries and, put a threaded pipe onto a threaded catch and go directly. But, listen, your ball, legislatures and legislators. You do something about it, because right now it's Tuffy the Mouse on you. It's Tony D'Angelo here on 30 with Tony. We'll be back with the rest of the show right after this.
He was moving up with me, then come waving goodbye in a little old souped-up jitney. I put my foot in my tank and I began to roll, moaning siren towards the state patrol. So I let out my wings and then I blew my horn. Bye-bye, New Jersey, I become airborne. Now you can't catch me, baby, you can't catch me. 'Cause if you get too close, you know I'm gone like a cool breeze. Flying with my baby last
Well, thanks, Kemosabes. Thanks for staying with me. You know, I was going to do another segment, but this thing with hunger has really caught me, because hunger to me is the failure of government and the political system and the economic system to provide a means of providing for its citizens. And I hope we did a good job of explaining that in the first segment, but I'm thinking we need to do more, because the amount of bureaucratic ineptitude and idiocy here just catches me, you know, six different ways. I'm a lot like my mother in that regard, that no person should go hungry. But I started to look at on the break these maps, if you can bear with me for a second. These are the interactive hunger maps. And to say, what is Feeding America talking about? I'm going to do a screen share, and you can pull up the different counties in Connecticut, and each one of them seem to be running at about, shall we say, a 12% or 13% food insecurity rate, if you want to use their buzzword. And my question to myself is, what does this mean to me? What do these numbers mean to me? I mean, government uses statistics like a lamppost to a drunk, something to lean on. But I don't want to lean. I want to take whatever's here. And obviously, this is a kind of a little bit overly ornate for my taste. I mean, why doesn't some of these dollars go to feeding the hungry? But, you know, then you don't need policy people and think tanks and bureaucrats and all of that. But what I'm curious is, how many meals are people who are food insecure behind? Because government does not seem to be asking that question. So if I were to take the annual, this is Western Connecticut, the annual food budget shortfall, $65,144,000, and the cost for meal of, say, $5, and provide for that number of people, how many meals are we talking? And I did that. I did that math up over here. 65,144 divided by 5 divided by 68,750. And that's 189 meals. So basically what that is that it tells me that every food insecure person needing 3 meals a day has a need for 2 calendar months. Now, your politicians and your Anwars and your Cavos Chagras will look at that and say, well, it's not enough. We've got to get it to 6 months. It's like, no, hey, wait a minute. If these numbers are good, and I really have no reason to doubt them as such, I probably could have done this in maybe a tenth of the cost. But if these numbers are good, what that tells me is people are unable to provide for themselves. And why is that? Is it because prices are too high? Is it because the cost of fuel and getting from place to place is economically limiting? You know, I have to laugh. Actually, some days you have nothing to do but laugh. The Biden administration is now off on this thing of, you know, the evil grocers are overcharging us. You know, the thing we looked at a few weeks back on the Lee Elsie show and the ridiculous idiocy of that and the low profit margins they deal with to begin with. Plus, you got to deal with the cost of fuel and the administration and the administrative state. Now in Connecticut, you got the sick day accrual. Now you've got the disastrous Sean Scanlon retirement plan and. You've got all these things. And, you know, we're now we've got to, you know, possibly provide strike benefits. I'm sorry, unemployment benefits for strikers. And, you know, all of that really means nothing. You know, it's not the fault of the bureaucracy. It's the fault of the evil store owner. Where anybody in a grocery store, literally any idiot will tell you that if the costs increase and people aren't coming in because your prices are too high, that's happening in the food stores right now. The revenues go down. When the revenues go down, the workers' hours get cut. And then when the profits get to a point where you can't keep the store open, you close the store. And then you're going to throw e-trucks and e-cars and all this other stuff on top of it. Okay. So that's government solution for you, which is like a one-way trip into a fiery garbage can. But this tells me that there is something wrong economically and socially if the food insecure are without meals for 2 months at a time. That's a problem. That's a problem. And what are we going to do? Are we going to raise the taxes so much that maybe they'll get 3 months of food? Are we going to fix the economy? I mean, do you see what's happening here? Do you see what's happening here? The problem keeps perpetuating itself. So the people that perpetuate the problem come to you and say there is a problem, and you could look at their salaries and you can look at what they're involved with, or they could self-deal, or they could be like Ned Lamont, was over there, loading up cars during COVID as his wife and he are working on a no-bid testing contract for the COVID vaccine. They could do all that, but are we going to get to the root of the problem? And we're not going to get to the root of the problem until we actually start to fix the problem, which is lower prices, higher wages, and better energy. Everything is driven by energy. We talked about that on the Lee Elsie show this past Tuesday. Everything. And there is nothing more aggravating to me than some pontificating, arrogant politician who doesn't think that, especially if they're a Republican, because they should know better. And they should know better. And they should know what they need to do. And they need to know they need to embrace the Trump energy policy. Whether you hate the man or not, he's got the right idea with that. So basically, if we're looking at 190 meals that need to be made up for these people, that tells me there's a huge economic problem. And that tells me that the economic problem is the crisis of failure. It is not the crisis of taxation and taxing the people who do more and have more to feed those that don't. Basically, the people that aren't feeding themselves, those that are able, need to be employed and need to be able to have affordable prices and affordable housing and better economies, which is done by a business-friendly environment, not by a stupid bureaucracy. And I don't know, I don't know what else I can do to make it more plain than that. I'm going to stop this share. Regardless of what they tell you, regardless of how they want to guilt you out, regardless of the legislative sponsorships for more programs, more this, more that, because they always will engender some office, some study, some growth of the administrative state, which is all your tax money. These people are still going hungry. And I don't think these people in the legislature have a clue nor care about the fact that these people are going hungry. They feel that their, whatever you want to call it, their myriad labyrinthine system of bureaucratic ineptitude will be the cure-all and end-all for all things. I mean, there was a president, Lyndon B. Johnson, with the Great Society, who really thought we could eliminate poverty. I mean, really, really thought that by programs and program spending, we would be able to eliminate poverty forever. And you could read about the disaster of the Great Society. You happen to be in front of a computer or a book or something like that, only remnants of it survived. And, it's like, how could I put it? Lyndon Johnson thought he knew more than Jesus Christ in Nazareth. Jesus said, you're going to have the poor with you forever. You will have the poor with you forever. The object is to have less of them by getting people away from poverty. And you're going to do that by making economies better and not by putting bureaucrats, programs, politicians, and bad energy policy in the way. It is simple as that and just as difficult. And I'm Tony D'Angelo. We'll be back with the close of the show right after this.
Hello, fun seekers. Since we like to mix fun with business, please enjoy another video classic clip, courtesy of the producers of 30 with Tony.
Today's classic clip is From Here to Eternity. From Here to Eternity is a 1953 American romantic war drama film directed by Fred Zinnemann and based on James Jones' 1951 novel of the same name. The story revolves around three United States Army soldiers stationed in Hawaii in the months leading up to the attack on Pearl Harbor. Burt Lancaster, Montgomery Clift, and Frank Sinatra deliver powerful performances as the soldiers, while Deborah Kerr and Donna Reed portray the women in their lives. The film explores themes of love, duty, and personal struggles against the backdrop of impending war. Notably, it won 8 Academy Awards, including Best Picture and Best Director. The title itself originates from Rudyard Kipling's poem Gentlemen Rankers, emphasizing the soldier's enduring challenges. So for today's classic clip, we replay the bar fight scene between Jail Sergeant Fatso Judson, played by Ernest Borgnine, and Maggio, played by Frank Sinatra.
Who's the broad?
It's my sister.
You hit me.
Yeah, and I'm about to do it again, too.
Boy, you dirty wop.
If you all want to fight, take it outside.
I'm going to cut this wop's heart out. Anybody steps in here, I give it to him first.
One step further, Fatso, and I'm going to debrain you.
Nobody's going to do nothing. Anybody does any killing around here, I'll do it.
This is a private affair, Warden.
No, it ain't. This man's in my company. And you ain't making 2 extra weeks paperwork for me for nothing.
Out for blood, huh? You'd puke your guts out at the sight of a dead man.
Put down that stool. Put it down! Drop that knife. Okay, Fatso. If it's killing you want, come on. Well, come on. On the floor. Kill us, huh? I'd trade the period for a good campfire girl.
Tough monkey. Guys like you end up in the stockade sooner or later. Someday you walk in, I'll be waiting. I'll show you a couple of things.
We will be back soon with more 30 with Tony.
To go.
Well, thanks, Kemosabes. A rough subject. Thank you for being here with me, and thank you for going through it. And believe me, I've never thought I have had every single answer correctly, but I know there are a lot better ways to be doing things, and we could be doing them much better than we are. But the reason why we don't do them is because we have a bureaucracy and a system that we have to validate. And I've got absolutely no patience with that, especially the older I get. The United States is in a rough place. The state of Connecticut is in a horribly rough place, largely because of the policies and the government and the people that have been involved. And, you know, it's like, it's time to change it. It's time to save it, because if we don't, it's only going to get worse, and it's only going to cost us more. And I think you could look at that. You can look at that through administrations. You could look at that over time. It's never changed. It's never changed because the political system has to validate itself by having more people and more budgets and more this and more that, and less people get help as the administrative monster gets bigger. But I think after all of that, let us end with a joke. Why is your dog more loyal than your wife? Well, give you a little experiment. Put your dog and your wife in the trunk of the car, leave them there for an hour. Open the trunk. Which one is actually happy to see you? Oh, please. I'll get some people angry with that, especially a very nice lady that lives here by the name of Kathleen D'Angelo. It's Tony D'Angelo here on 30 with Tony. Thanks, Kemosabes. Thanks for staying with us. Hope you enjoyed the music, the classic clips, and the show. We'll be back next week with more stuff. As Dick Clark would say in American Bandstand, so long. Thanks again.